more pristine there, because we did see a couple miscommunication plays. We saw Pi relocate and Envy popped his BKB, yep, and then they got both of them killed basically off of that. But I do think that they can still bring it back.
Do you not think it puts more pressure on them for this final game? Because they have to win this now, surely.
It does. And especially considering like how unpredictable these groups have been. Mm. Like, some teams dropping down, you're like, wait, this shouldn't happen. Like, what happens if OG drops down and you get like OG versus Secret coming through? I don't know how the grids are made.
Yeah.
But like, if that matchup ends up happening...
You won't know, by the way, until the main event.
Right. Okay, we don't know.
That's a big deal.
So it's not clear cut?
No.
No, it's
not being revealed.
The pairings, after the upper bracket versus lower bracket are determined, the pairings are randomized.
And obviously this is to stop teams from getting the matchups they want.
Exactly. Yeah. They don't want anybody throwing matches during the group phase. And the matchups matter a huge deal.
But you're right. I mean, if it carries on the way it is right now, and Empire wins,
there's the AA
phase.
This is where
your predictions just go completely like...
This is actually a great, great open by Secret here. The AA open against the Whispers.
Oh, hello.
What?
We had the IO Drow. They have played it before.
But they did. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't a first phaser.
Nope.
This is a crazy open by any other. And see, this is the thing about Wings that I really love talking about their draft. Any other teams, you throw up their hand and go like, okay, they're throwing the strap. They don't know what they're doing. But Wings, like, they can make something out of any lineup.
They don't want it to get banned, probably, as well. Like right away they pick the Wisp, and they're probably like, oh god, teams are looking at us about banning it.
Out of all the heroes that you have to and think about banning against Wings, do you really think Secret picks up and bans the Drow?
I think they might second phase. I think that's the problem.
I don't know.
No,
the IO again. They know that they beat it last time round. Do they then think, well, what else have they played with it? They played with the Drow.
Is Wings forcing a reaction from Secret? Like, this is the kind of stuff which
it's
like,
going to make them think.
If you talk to like players like Swindles, he loves to do this kind of stuff in the draft, where he's just like, I'm going to get this and this, because I know it's going to just completely confuse the other team. They won't know exactly what we're doing. And like you take something extraordinary like this, and then you make it ordinary. You know what you're going to end up getting, and then they'll be like, no, they're trying something new out of the box.
Yeah,
like it's Axe Wyvern jungle. It's
unconventional, but it's not unusual.
Instills fear, like in a matter, because now you're looking, you're like, oh god, we got to ban what Visage, we got to ban these weird heroes.
You got to ban the Venge is the number one thing, and then it's down to like the Visage, the Windranger, or.
So see, the funny thing is too, like, you don't even need
maybe
that.
The puck.
Like, you don't even need to start banning out these heroes, because you also understand the Drow Ranger by yourself can just function. Like, if you have like a range hero in the lane, obviously you get a little bit more, but like Drow still adds a nice little bit of early push, and you can make it work anywhere. like I still actually really enjoyed the old Arteezy thing. Like, when Arteezy died three times in the mid lane as Conqueror, I'm like, hey, it would have been really great if he was a Drow Ranger then, because then it would still work.
I want to add one thing though.
Go ahead.
I think that Wings is going to do something that they did recently and go for this Oracle, because they are playing versus Beastmaster. So I think Secret should really ban the Oracle here, because it's extremely good versus the Beastmaster. However, AA is really strong.
Did they not ban it game one?
Yeah. First of all,
it was banned in the second phase.
First of all, AA, which you already mentioned. Yes. But second of all, I think you bait the Oracle pick here, because that gives Wings two very naturally defensive supports, and that's not the style that they like to play.
But it depends how you play, because Oracle also gives you a lot of burst damage early
on. I'm just saying what they've used recently and what is good.
Sure.
Of course, it's very good versus Beastmaster in general. You know, you remove the Roar right away. It gives them a lot more laning pressure. Of course, not the rotation pressure, but then they just pick stronger lanes and other heroes in the other lanes. Like, in the one that they did, they had Queen of Pain, Puck, Wisp, Drow, and Oracle. So they had these self-sufficient other laners, and then they had the Oracle just sticking with the Drow.
Yeah, which is why it's odd that they've banned.
That's
out the
really
back.
Good. I'm not sure I'm on board with it, but
they're probably worried about like who's going to be the initiation, because if Drow is one of the callers on the mid or the safe lane, like you look towards the offlane initiation, and Batrider is still fantastic for that.
They might just be completely deterred from it though by the AA, because we do know the AA blast, of course, is amazing versus Oracle, but removing Roar instantly, if you're able to do that and get him out of the way of that AA blast.
See, it's just so, as an analyst, it's so hard to analyze Wings, because most other teams have a fairly structured set of early rotations on their support pairings. Wings is just going to do whatever the hell they want.
It's fine, Alan. None of their players know what their captain's doing right now either. Absolutely fine. It's just Wings things. That's all it is.
But they're such a fun team to analyze and talk about precisely for that reason.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it was that conversation we were having this morning with Seb.
Exactly.
Where we're just like, hey, Wings is really good. It's like, they are the biggest headache to draft against, because you just don't know.
Yeah, we talked about the fact that coaches will really help teams playing against wings, but I'm not so sure anymore. I think they're actually screwing with their minds worse than they would do if they didn't have a coach.
It's perfect. I love it.
No, I tried the exercise actually before because there were a couple people who I speak to in Dota that I respect that said, okay, well, wings is going to get figured out. And so I tried this exercise before this tournament. I said, okay, if I'm scouting them, if I'm putting together a dossier on them for another team, what do I write up?
What are the main points?
And the dossier would have been like 60 pages long. Like it's either 60 pages or 2 pages. They run at you, or here's all the different things that they've done with these different hero sets because they're very diverse in what they do.
There's a puck on secret.
Well, this is also feel like a semi-block
pick. That's actually also a deny
pick.
Yes.
We're on it, man. We're on it.
Like we were saying, the self-sufficient solo laners and puck is one of those. So I like that pick.
Now also means that Team Secret are revealed two of their lanes. Like that's Arteezy mid and that's a Beastmaster off. Like wings can just go for something a little bit more stable. You can go into something like an Invoker for that mid lane, something you feel really confident with.
They're not 100% committed to that. You still can't go puck off lane beast, but yeah, given what their players do and what they like to run,
you could push the Beastmaster into a fall position, but I'd be a little bit concerned doing that, as well as having the AA.
Does wings go back to like their crazy Venno thing here too?
It wouldn't be bad for fights, but I prefer to see something which is a little bit more direct push.
No, I don't think he can.
And that is
direct. Oh, boy. Okay.
Is it actually going to be what we talked about earlier today? Is it the double dragon lens?
Maybe.
Is it the push up high ground?
Maybe. I mean, they're one of the teams that would probably do something like that that's very out of the box.
So you get double dragon lance on Prophet as well as Straight Ranger, and you can attack tier 3 talents at around 15, 16 minutes in because you just take so much already, and like it's not even a sieging high ground. You actually assault the high ground by doing it.
Yeah, but that's all like it's all well and good on paper, but then you have a team in Secret that already has multiple ways to initiate into you while you're doing that. Like that's not
it's
pretty scary.
I'm not saying it's a flawless strat.
I also think that they could be just be prepping for taking a game to the late stages because they see the puck picked up, they see the Beastmaster picked up. They know it's probably going to be a single core draft.
I hate it.
So they have
though.
Drow, and then they have Furin, and then if they go for another.
But,
another core?
No, Giannis, like, I hate that idea just because, so Furion, I believe in this patch, it's similar stat too in the last patch, but in this patch, I believe he's 2-11 in 50-plus minute games.
Yes.
Drow falls off precipitously past about 45 minutes.
This is early push.
You give
or
yourself a window by
push.
Doing that? Yeah.
Yeah,
it's got to be
early
push.
You just use your army. Like, you bring in a whole bunch of Treants, they back up when you're pushing.
This
the Ember Spear
really
from Secret.
This is nice for Secret.
They invest a lot into their late game. They know if they can make it past this early push of Wings, they're going to be in a real, real solid position. But Wings have really good push themselves. They can burn through these buildings.
This is why I wanted them to ban the Windranger over the Batrider, because we all know Envy likes to go toward that Ember Spirit. It's one of his go-to comfort heroes, but at the same time, the Windranger is a bit of a natural counter to the Ember Spirit, and you've got the Drow Aura, of course, on top of that in this game. Any minus armor is going to end the Ember Spirit.
Ricky, last one, really?
Ricky ban.
That's actually not that bad.
It's not what I was thinking, though. I was thinking like still something that's going to support the push. Something like Chen, even if you want to start triggering people, Jakiro. Yeah. You haven't brought that one up. I thought you would have since Epicenter.
A lot of people talking about mid-THQ.
I've got some inside information.
I'm sorry, Red.
We're going to see tomorrow.
I blew your secret.
Yeah.
Are we going to see mid-THD?
We're going to see Jakiro tomorrow.
Okay.
Mid-THD.
Calling it now.
We're going back to the days of THD versus TA.
Like, I swear, half a dozen different people have brought that up to me, like, that mid-THD can actually crush DK. I don't know about that. But, like, seriously, so many people are talking about that.
Yeah. Complexity boys were talking about it around the restaurant in Russia.
Yep.
Huh. They really were.
And they definitely brought their A game to this event already.
Yeah. Shut up, Toby.
Wow. That was a good BM.
That really was.
Swindles and I are good. We're fine.
So wow. Dark's here, Ben.
He's definitely not going to be happy with today, but he'll also take it on the chin.
All right, final two picks.
Dark's here, Ben's a bit weird.
So what? Visage is there. And...
I just stay simple, take Lion.
Lion's probably the most appropriate just to deal with this Ember Spirit.
I mean, of course,
that's not a Wings hero.
They prefer something far.
Although
more
every hero is a Wings hero.
I guess so, right? And I don't think they'll pick the Oracle. I said it before that they might, but it's not very good. Yeah, they go.
Okay, Ruben.
Okay.
Yeah, that's actually their like second most picked second hero, most picked. So I should have been on that. Yeah.
Five range lineup.
But Wisp Rubick supports is very underwhelming.
But at least it gives you the option of the disable, and it gives you the positioning option with the tether. They're capable of running Rubick. They're very comfortable with the hero. They're capable of running it in a very aggressive style. It's much less the static lane support in their hands.
And it gives you the no field to deal with at least some of the magic damage coming up from Secret.
Which is very relevant going into that.
Okay, very quickly, Alan. Which has had the better draft here?
I think Secret are in their... I'm going to go against my prediction for the series because I think Secret are in their comfort zone with this draft. This is a very, very different looking draft from game one. I think they take it.
Subby?
I really actually like Secret's draft, but it's difficult to go against Wings when they have two of my favorite heroes, Prophet as well as Dro, together.
Oh my god.
I actually feel like Wings are going to win this with... in the first, 25 to 30 minutes, or they lose.
Okay, all right.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to go with Wings this game, going against my prediction from earlier.
All right, okay. Wings, do they take it in Game 3, or do Secret carry on with a chance of making the upper bracket in the main event? Let's find out as we head back to our commentary team. Cap, it's all yours.
Thank you, Red. Very good question indeed. Who's going to be the first team taken out of Group D? We're about to find out. Out at as game number 3 between Team Secret and Wings starts now. Huh.
God damn it, God.
Are you prepared?
Every single time now I hear who, that's always going to be in my head.
All right, well, here we have the Team Secret side. Envy, the Sven from last game. Universe playing an old school, could be a throwback on the Earthshaker.
No. I'm a fan. I'm good. Oh, those eyes. Jesus, I can't even look at that screen. Sorry, I can't look at the screen anymore.
Arteezy's eyes. He's seen some things.
Yeah, he's seen Secret playing, apparently. No, Game 3, Wings, Secret, things...
I kind of feel like Drone Ranger first picks are kind of like a slap to the face of the enemy team. It's kind of like, ha, we could just run a Drone Ranger strat. You can't counter it despite having 3 picks to do so. What are your thoughts on this kind of weird drafting style from Wings?
I agree with that, but it's like Wings have done this before. Just before coming to this tournament when they won the Summit Chinese qualifiers against Vici Gaming Reborn, they did this exact opening 2 mm-hmm. picks, the IO plus the Drone Ranger. So this is something they've done before, they're very comfortable with. And being on that dire side, it can snowball out of control very quickly. And I think something important that Fog mentioned was when they see the Puck plus Beastmaster, they're probably thinking, like, we can actually also go pretty well into the late game. You look at just the cores alone, like Windranger, Nature's Prophet, Dro Ranger against, what, Puck, Beastmaster? I guess Beastmaster's kind of the jungling, but let's say he's one of the 3 cores. Ember Spirit, like, the late game of Secret's actually not that scary.
Mm-hmm. It is just pretty much all in the hands of the Ember Spirit when it comes to the real damage late game. But now we have an Earthshaker offlane and also the support of Ancient Apparition scales decently well into the late. Wings will have, I think, plenty of opportunities to be able to win this game, but it's going to come in some very specific timings. And one of the earliest ones is obviously going to be our laning phase, where we've got a Windranger matched up against a Puck, but the Windranger's got the extra Dro Ranger aura. And then bottom lane, you've got Bian as a Furion, but he's also got the damage, and he's putting to use against Eternal Envy. He's taken so much damage already.
Yeah, has boots so he can chase even further if he wants to. But yeah, this is not a fun lane for Envy from the get-go. Pilot Eye not really there to zone, and Ice has done a solo smoke bottom on Rubick, so perhaps thinking they can get this early kill, although Envy's back to full HP, so he's going to have to wait for some harass here first.
I mean, he's probably still right, though. Pylai Dai is going to step a little bit too far forward, gets the telekinesis, and with all that right-click damage, it's going to be real easy for Ice to pick up the first blood.
Yeah. Not going to Faith Bian, which would have been the ideal hero to get it because you get the fast phase boots, but still pretty good with Ice getting the early money.
And for obvious reasons, the Dro Ranger lane is also going to go quite well. Earthshaker. I mean, in that regard, I would say that Beastmaster offlane, probably actually, that's like one of the few lanes you probably wouldn't do real well, and you'd have to just go jungle anyway. So yeah. It does kind of make sense to pick up one of those heroes like the old, you know, Earthshaker offlane or the Clockwork offlane or something like that that is able to just get a little something out of scenarios that most other offlaners cannot.
Yeah, and they're not really expecting the Earthshaker to be like that big scary farm core here in the late game. Puppy's going to probably be more farm than Universe throughout this entire game, but this is very much just setting up, getting as much farm out of the map as possible.
Oh, Bien, that was not the play. Tries to go for the teleport out, doesn't actually make it. Ice turns around, gets a little more damage on Pylai Dive, and almost dies in the process. Good play, though, by Secrets, the Furion. It's kind of like the cat chasing the mouse, the dog chasing the cat. Chasing after Ice, Furion chases after the Ancient Apparition, but in the end, it's going to be Eternal Envy, who's the supreme predator. Meanwhile, Arteezy may actually go down in the middle lane. He's got a phase shift, dodges both of those projectiles. Bien had it. Oh, what a Treant! Okay.
That Treant has done his dues. He can retire happy.
Yeah, he really can. He's going to get a little bit more. He's going to get a boar as well. Get him, sick him. All right.
Cruelty. Somebody call PETA. Well,
GP back to mid, but... Puppy, I think you need to go back to base, my friend.
A bit
I don't
of
think
scrappy,
the Furion's going to leave you alone.
Scrappy early game, but yeah. Oh, boy. Puppy needs to be careful here, actually.
Yeah, he really does. There is the Sprout ready to go. So Bien's going to be able to block out Puppy a little bit more. Looks like should still be fine, though. Puppy's okay. Draws Arteezy over here. Now the Ancient Apparition actually coming in from the side while Arteezy takes a break from the mid lane to get some revenge on Bien and will be able to do so.
I think too aggressive from Bien. This is still, you're 3 minutes in, Bien. We saw this last game where Wings just went a little bit too aggro in the laning stage. Like they're at their strongest when they start hit that like 10 to 15 minute timing and start playing aggressive. And I think a solo Nature's Prophet leading the way for kills is not the way to go. You want to have the Prophet being that second or third hero to the fight with teleport. So
yeah.
Setting up camp in the enemy jungle, perhaps not the right approach at this stage of the game. Maybe if he had the phase boots already from the first blood, but he didn't get the money for it. He hasn't picked up any of those blades of attack yet.
And this actually turned into a really weird scenario where Rubik was the one who picked up the first blood and has also been spending more time in the offlane than the Furion is. So he is actually almost level 4 and he's already got arcane boots.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds great, but realistically, like, an arcane boots this early on doesn't actually give your team all that much when you're not grouping up. Maybe if Rubik's sitting bottom lane spamming Fade Bolt on Envy, it's kind of annoying, but at best, it's just that. It's annoying.
Yeah, and who else of your team really makes use of a whole lot of mana? This is a Draw Ranger strat, after all. A lot of them are going to be focused on just being right-clickers.
Yeah.
So...
I think they're just expecting Puppy. Something with the Beastmaster jungle is the hero is often very low HP while jungling. You have to ferry out extra regen, extra salve. So if you do catch him on low HP, you can find like maybe a cheap, easy kill, but that wasn't the case with Nature's Prophet.
Ice. It's a little too close there. Ancient Apparition and Ember Spirit able to run him away, and he has to actually TP out because Puppy was going to cut off his retreat as well. We haven't really talked too much about Universe, but he actually rotated down to the bottom lane. Obviously, that top lane is just never going to be a whole lot of fun for him. He's already picked up the Soul Ring just to kind of Fissure spam his way to some success, but... In the end, the laning phase is still going to go much better for Wings, it seemed, at least at first. With the Furion kills and Arteezy actually kind of getting back into the swing of things, he's evened up in CS against Blink.
Yeah. And they're kind of lacking kill potential on the puck. Something that you'd normally see like a Windranger like Dendi do is max Shackle Shot in this mid lane. And I think it's a much better way to play. You're going to get more damage out of the focus fire when you're playing with the precision ore on your team, and that's where you're much better off going for the max Shackle build. So I think Blink perhaps not as comfortable playing something like a Windranger mid with the Drow, and also with the Nature's Prophet teeping in, you want to have that extra bit of disable for the Shackle. The Sprout even sets up the free Shackle, so...
Yeah, exactly.
We'll Puppy. See. Level 6 now means marksmanship is up, so a lot of extra damage output coming from all of the Wings heroes.
Mm-hmm. Puppy is pretty much a 3 position, at least when it comes to farm priority now. Earthshaker, unable to do anything at the top lane, is very rapidly falling farther and farther behind, but that really is what an Earthshaker or Clockwork offlaners do. They just need some levels. Ice is going to show up. He smoked up for this position. Will be able to get the pullback. Shadow comes forward. Should be able to slow down Universe enough. Arteezy does come in with a Dream Cult, but there's not a whole lot of follow-up TPs here, and Arteezy, silenced up, isn't actually able to get out in time, it looks like, as the orb is only going to be able to get him so much space and instant actually kills him first before Arteezy could get the kill on the support, 2-for-nothing, as Wings just outpositioned Secret. There really should have been more TPs from Secret. If Arteezy's going to TP to that top lane, Ember Spirit needs to be there, maybe one of the supports as well.
Yeah, just that. If you're going to TP, TP everyone, but I think perhaps it may have just been better to ditch the tower. They didn't quite recognize how many numbers Wings have TPing in, but you're playing against the Nature's Prophet. That's the like go-to move for a Nature's Prophet at this stage of the game. You're ready to push the top tower, you get the ward behind, you get the supports initiating in with the telekinesis, and then Prophet TPs in to give you that 4v1 plus tower, or a 4v2 in that scenario, because Arteezy gives them the extra freebie.
Yeah. It seems like another situation where, when we're watching Secret, where there's just not good enough communication. Because if I'm Arteezy, I'm expecting maybe Eternal Envy to TP there, but EE, I believe he actually TP'd back to base and remnanted to bottom, because when we looked at bottom lane, his TP was actually on cooldown. That's why he didn't show.
And that's where perhaps like Puppy and Envy need to be communicating, keeping tabs on those things. Hey, Puppy, because he also wasn't level 6 yet. If you have a roar, then it's a great time to try and counterplay that. But Puppy had to make the call like, okay, Universe, you're going up there, but if they dive you, if they make that play, we're not going to back you up. They almost have to have talked about it before the dive actually happened, and it didn't feel like that was the case.
Well, maybe they will have discussed this one. Eternal Envy is going to be able to catch Shadow here in place. The telekinesis throwback isn't going to be enough as Shadow is caught by the Cold Feet, and Eternal Envy lays claim to the enemy carry. Still though, Blink is actually wrapping around here. He's got the haste rune, he's got the opportunity, the angle for the shackle shot onto Universe, should be able to finish up maybe before the Fissure? Yeah, comes out at the same time. Either way, they get the kill.
They have roll though, this could backfire.
Yeah, Eternal Envy's gonna go straight for Innocence here. He does, oh, maybe not, doesn't have the jump away in time. Oh, barely, as just in time, the Primal Roar is able to stop Blink, and now here comes the combo as Arteezy is able to put a stop to a lot of this. Just the TP out from the Rubick is the only one to escape from that Dream Coil, but they get the bigger kill and the Wind Ranger. Now
oh, relocate back in.
Silence onto Arteezy. They've got him. A big kill there. They're going to look for a little bit more as Bien pops himself out, goes for the Sprout play. He's got the drums activated too. They have a slight movement speed advantage, but they have to be careful. A Fissure on three underneath the tier two with Eternal Envy backing them up as well. He does get silenced up, and they're going to try and right click him down, but now the stuns come in, and Eternal Envy should be able to finish off Shadow. If this right click damage sprouted up, oh no, Eternal Envy's actually going to die. Shadow starts running himself. Oh, the Fissure misses. Shadow, he has to juke his way through this one somehow, but not going to be able to do it. The Enchant Totem catches him. Bien, meanwhile, is stuck inside this awkward position. He does have a Sprout. He's going to go for it now, but Arteezy is able to jump onto him with the Orb Silence, finishing him up. Again, Wings' over-aggression may be costing them this laning phase.
Yeah, they're just taking the fight to Secret a bit too hard and a bit too early on the game, giving them a lot of kills to turn things around there, and that is kind of unnecessary aggression coming out from Wings. I feel like you hit your timing with the Joe Ranger, like, a bit later, like around that, again, the 12 to 15 minute mark, that's where Wings really thrive, and they're just trying to force it a bit too much. Take a tower with like a 4-man rotation, that's one thing, but diving that deep near the tier 2 towers, they really overstayed their welcome.
Yeah, they certainly did. Arteezy going for that 10 minute rune, the Furion's gonna back him up though, and that's why Arteezy abandons hope for that rune, but they get the shackle shot surrounding Arteezy, he will end up going down. That's the combination that Wings should be able to operate with a little bit more, rather than going for these strange 4-man, 3-man, tier 2 dives.
Yeah, that's a really good TP from Faith Bian.
They get the tier 1 tower off of that too.
And those are the kinds of kills which will guarantee you a tower. They could possibly rotate bottom and try to get a second tier 1, or even go for Roshan. This early on in the game, they've got the damage output with the precision aura, though Drow Ranger not in the neighborhood.
Hylodyne knows. He's died enough in his time as a player. He knows what's going to be happening. Wings are going to make that full rotation down to bottom lane, put some pressure on this tier 1, and if he's sitting even behind the tier 1 in that tree area, they're probably going to go for the dive. So he backs out before he gets his level 6. The rest of the team is going to smoke up though and still try and catch Wings shortly after they take it. Universe cutting across, looking for the Fissure opening. They do get the Primal Roar. Blink manages to get off the Wind Run first. Now the Primal Roar turn around on the Universe. He doesn't manage to get off the Fissure, and they get the relocate save. Universe even goes down before getting off anything. Still though, Eternal Envy, beautiful jump in, will be able to lay claim to two, but Arteezy's gonna be the turnaround kills. They get the silence onto him and beat him to a pulp. Secret with Wings, 2 for 2, but that was a smoke exchange. And that was also Wind Ranger and Drow Ranger picking up some of those kills.
And that was one of those moments where you just feel like Secret get the jump, they're catching Wings by surprise, it's going to go terribly wrong. But Wings just make some great instinctive defensive plays. The Rubick gets the insta-steal on Roar and finds the perfect target, prevents the Fissure, the Echo Slam to immediately follow up the Roar. And then they also get the relocate save as well. Everything that Wings needed to do in a split second was done.
Yeah. And now, Wings, having just won a fight not too far away from the Roshan pit, as you said, they can rather easily do it. And this time around, Universe does not have a Blink Dagger to make some sort of $3 million Echo Slam play, or maybe he does. Fissure actually goes out on to three. Eternal Envy's going to be silenced up, but Universe walks straight into him with the Echo Slam. Never mind, he may have actually gotten that stolen. Ice Ice turns around, gets a minimal amount of damage onto both Secret, and they still are going to lose one to Eternal Envy as he moves forward. Eternal Envy jumps back in, goes for Innocence. He's got the backup over Marteezy. The Drain Claw locking down both of them. Marteezy marches forward. He should be able to get... Oh, couldn't quite finish off Shadow before he died. But still, it's going to be a huge win for Secret either way, as they take out four members of Wings for just Eternal Envy, and now they're going to be able to claim Roshan for themselves.
That's a team wipe with a buyback on Nature's Prophet, an absolutely terrible fight for Wings. They're really forcing it there, perhaps. Oh, they're going to try and fight this.
Whoa, okay, the Sprout goes down. This is definitely a lineup that is dependent on Roshan, but how much can you really do with this one? Oh, they just barely managed to take away that Aegis as well as finishing off the Earthshaker. Ban, he's actually going to be able to get I die as well. These crazy right clicks. Primal roared at the last second, but it doesn't matter. The shot was already there, finishing off the Ancient Apparition, and now the backup. Ice Ice chops down the trees. Not good enough to be able to save the Furion. Ice Ice challenging Arteezy, though, even further, bringing back that telekinesis. And the power shot actually missed. Good phase shift.
He's gonna be cut off, though.
Yeah, you see on the other side, Toronto Ranger ready to go. Has the silence. Arteezy knows he's trapped like a rat. He will end up going down. Somehow, Wings go from throwing the Roshan fight to kind of recovering it.
Yeah, kind of. The Aegis gets immediately dispelled by killing off Puppy there, who had to pick it up because of how low he was, but Wings instantly on the aggression. It was such an unnecessarily forced Roshan, it felt like. They're huddled in the pit with Ice Blast coming in. If they want to go for that, I feel like you've got to have a sentry just to have the detection for the Ice Blast, so you know it's coming and can at least get out of the pit. But Ice Blast with a Fissure, trapping, like, two heroes were even trapped against the wall inside the Roshan pit, meant they were just caught in this terrible, awkward position where Secret are going to win a team fight against them.
Yeah. I mean, how do they possibly lit an Earthshaker just run into melee range with them like that?
It feels like they're going to need an early kind of pipe of some sort. The other thing is Rubick not going for any points in null field. This spell actually received some 6.87 changes where the level 1 point in it went from 5% to 10%, and that's a big upgrade in terms of overall magic resistance against a lineup which is very magic damage heavy. So I think he should have gone for at least one less point in the telekinesis when considering the overall game plan of Wings.
Yeah. Oh, the stun on the Blink. He gets blown up immediately. Fissure, Primal Roar, and an Ice Blast as they catch him out with a well-timed sentry placement.
So there will be a mech coming out from Faith Bian. The item you kind of expect on the Nature's Prophet, although not quite as effective considering you're reversing the Ancient Apparition. If Secret get the right initiation with a Fissure and the Ice Blast, that one hero is going to get taken out. And that's really the beauty of Secret's draft. It's very good at focusing down a single target. And rather than spreading the damage across where you're going to get value out of that mech, one hero is getting blown up and the mech is going to get taken out of the equation.
Yeah. And that Blink Dagger on Earthshaker is, I think, what is going to allow Secret to continually get those kind of initiations with the Ice Blast. Yeah. They're going to be able to focus down one hero like the Wind Ranger with that kind of instant blink in, disable of Echo Slam, follow up Fissure. Arteezy just used an orb offensively and is maybe going to be caught out here. Managed to dodge the Shackle Shot. He has the orb coming out, but good silence relocate play from Wings. Make sure that Arteezy is punished.
Yeah, I think this game is actually going to turn into a more late game oriented play and something. Like, some of the panel were kind of talking about, like, okay, you got to win before 25 minutes with the Dro, but at the same time, at this stage, Wings aren't going to do that. You're against the Blink Earthshaker. You're pushing into a Fissure Ice Blast combo, a Puck with a Veil, an Ember Spirit who's going to be working towards a Battle Fury once, like, that those initial pushes get defended. So I think more than anything, Wings want to be able to find pickoffs and scale into the late game. You can find pickoffs with Shadow going into a Shadow Blade. Very fitting. It just means he can then initiate by himself and then find an IO plus Wind Ranger relocate in. Orchid is going to be the item for Wind Ranger. Everyone's actually going for pickoff items on the Wing side, recognizing that this game is not going to be a pure, let's just push our way to victory using Dro Ranger, using Aegises, and just using this big five-man play.
Yeah, I'm definitely with you on that. It seems like plan A, they screwed up too much for that to be an option. They're not going to be able to push high ground by 20 or something like that. So time for plan B. And it's not a terrible one at that. He still will have insane damage on this Hero Ranger and Wind Ranger. And even the Furion can start building into more of a right-click role if he wants to. Shadowblade is complete, and that means, like, Eternal Envy as well as Arteezy do really have to be careful with their positioning. They're going to be used to being able to sit really far forward on these heroes and split push, but that may not be the case with the Shadowblade picked up.
See where these first pickups will go. There's such great global ganking potential with Relocate and the Nature's Prophet TP, but a lot of good initiators, and imagine Blink maybe eyeing off a Blink Dagger after he gets the Orchid.
Looks like a smoke play.
And Secret know they just dewarded some of that aggressive vision from Wing, so this is a good time to push out the lanes and go for a smoke themselves.
Okay, maybe not. The Shadowblade has been spotted, though, by the Roshan Ward placed by Secret, so this will come as no surprise to them. They're even going to spot it a second time with the Ward-Counter-Ward combination. They're inside their own jungle, so Secret are definitely getting the better of this exchange as they are pushing out the top lane. They're going to be able to control mid as well. Giving up control of their jungle is fine at this point in time. They know how dangerous Wings is at this point.
Yeah, I think Secret just want to, again, map control, always have detection here. Puppy's going to go straight into the Necro 3. We saw the Crimson Guard last time, and it was a great pickup. That was, even though Secret lost that game, Puppy was like kind of the most impactful player throughout against Na'Vi. But this time around, I think he's recognized they have enough answers to the push and the just kind of damage output of Wings by just being able to blow them up with Puck as well as Earthshaker. So he wants to have that utility of the Necro Book as well as that extra bit of damage output and detection.
Blink Dagger for the Rubick, but there's the Necronomicon. Number two already up, and number three is not going to be too far away if Arteezy can continue to take down some of these towers. Is going to be first one that Secret has claimed in the game so far. Wings not actually contesting. They're going to go for a tier two at bottom.
And Wings going to just turn this into a game of trades where if Secret push a tower, they'll try to get one in return. If Secret ever split up, they'll try and find those pickoffs, but not a game where they want to ever really try and take Secret head on until they get much more in the way of items. They're going to need BKBs. Not immediately, but sometime in the near future.
Yeah. Jump around. Turn Lemmy. Backs himself out. Arteezy shows himself in bottom lane with the TP covering him as well. He's not careful. That Shadowblade might have caught him out. We do get the Dream Call on the Shadow. He's going to go TP way. Maybe the Primal Roar. Actually, the Relocate out is just in time. It's a TP. Wouldn't have made it. Wings, will this be a clean extraction by them? They still have the Wisp being left, but he's going to go for a tether play. Actually, Eternal Envy, knowing that's exactly going to be happening here. BN is going to be caught by at least that, but managed to get the TP away. Innocence is still going to go down in the end. Wings unable to save their support.
Had to roll for it as well, though, so at least gives them some peace of mind for the next 65 seconds that there won't be a roar coming in. But overall, looked like a really bad position for Wings to be in there with the getting caught near the tier 2 tower, because they hung around, I think, trying to prevent a deny, but it was just kind of an unrealistic expectation when you've got a Blink Earthshaker coming in, the roar from the Beastmaster, but they cut their losses only losing the IO.
Scan going out, there's the Orchid, so
I'm not convinced this item really changes what, like, Wings' game plan or allows them to get more aggressive. It means they just have another hit. This just pretty much turns Windranger into a draw as well, where you've got that silence, so if you ever find someone by yourself, you can kill them with the Relocate in.
Yeah.
So you've now got two heroes you can go hunting with Windranger and draw, and even the Rubick with a Blink Lift can set up for kills as well with the Relocate in.
Which kind of means that Secret always need to have a battle buddy behind one of these cores that's going to be pushing out the wave, whether it's the Puck or the Ember Spirit. You see Pylod Eyes kind of operating as that for now. The Earthshaker is also going to give some much-needed extra protection, though.
Not sure. Yeah, battle buddy who's not Pylod Eyes.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like the one hero who, if you're the Ember and Pi's right behind you, like you, he's not going to be able to help you much.
Unless Pylod Eyes is like face-checking the incoming gank for you. Yeah. He's like, don't worry, guys, I'll tank it.
That's normally been the Pylod Eye play historically. So. But yeah, Shaker's sitting behind
All right. Envy. Here's the play. Shackle shot. There's the Orchid as well. The relocate is coming out. They manage to get the Fissure, but it's not going to be able to stop the Drone Ranger from finishing him off. They throw off the Echo Slam, but that's not good enough. And now Universe is going to be caught as well. They anticipated that kind of gank, I think, from maybe the Drone Ranger. I don't think they knew about the Orchid just yet. Yeah. They anticipated that kind of gank, but because the Wind Ranger was the one setting it up and they had the relocate follow up, that was just too much for a secret to be able to counter.
And it felt like they got overconfident once that shackle misses. They're like, okay, they missed the shackle. Yeah, he's silenced, but let's go back and initiate. And they needed to really save the fissure to deal with the relocate coming in. Echo Slam on its own, not enough. And that's also a situation where, just what we said, Pylai died. Not really the best counter-initiating hero. You need the Beastmaster Roar. The Earthshaker alone can't deal with all three heroes unless they happen to group up as three, which was not the way Wings positioned it.
Careful there, Ice. Like what he's doing. Just farming that medium camp. He's got a lot of aggressive vision around this Radiant Jungle. And seeing any potential rotations up to him, while also his team keeping the mid lane pushed out as well.
The game does feel a bit worrying for Secret right now. It's not feeling like a typical Drone Ranger game where it's like, okay, we've survived the push, they're not snowballing, they haven't won the game. No, it just feels like Drone's just another kind of fairly, like, average late game carry, but against a lineup which also doesn't have much late game carry. But Wings have way more tools to find pickoffs to actually control the tempo of the game. Even without pushing, they're still going to be the ones dictating play.
Yeah. See what happens with Roshan round two for Wings. Already seems like they're going to be a little bit gun-shy about going for that.
And there's not really any reason to get caught in the Rosh pit again. They can just keep the lanes pushed out and make it so that you know where Secret are on the map. If you can split Secret up, that's going to be when you're at your strongest.
Between the Ember Spirit, Puck Blink, the Universe Blink as well, there's so many ways for Secret to be able to catch you during Roshan, but they're actually going to be the ones going for the aggressive play here. Smoke up, move forward, there goes the jump, they managed to catch Shadow, trying to get the relocate out, but it's not going to be good enough. The Echo Slam actually stopping that one in its track, so they get two for it, and now get Tier 1 and probably Roshan with that.
Yeah, really, really nice timing on the smoke. Knowing that it's Rosh is going to be up, your opponent's unlikely to go for it, but they had a gem on Puppy, they had all the detection they needed, and if they can find a kill in that vicinity, you're either going to get Roshan, Towers, or a bit of everything, and Wings are not in a position to contest this at all. They're just going to go for the trade in top/bottom, and it will be a Tier 2 tower claim, but the much bigger prize being the Aegis here for Team Secret.
This means Eternal Envy. He's going to be that big-time brawler that you really like to see the Ember Spirit around 25 minutes, where he's just up in your face constantly, and Second Life will behoove him to act as such.
It's not the easiest for Secret's lamp to force fights, though, is one of the big problems. Even with the potential Blink pickup on Puppy when they've got Blink Roar, they've got the Puck as well, but Wings are always going to avoid any kind of fight. If you try and push with the Aegis, you haven't got the best pushing lineup, and it's very apparent to Wings, who will then just immediately send their Wind Ranger, their Drow, to a side lane to split push.
Yeah. Pi, apparently thinking that he's not going to be using the Ice Blast in the next 30 seconds, throws out that ult to be able to pick up a couple of CS and start moving towards that Aghanim's. Gonna decent little stack there on the Radiant Ancient camp. Wings farming their own Ancients, and keeping themselves rather spread, trying to farm efficiently, while they very clearly know now is not the time to be aggressive.
Yeah, with Wings, it's really just slow down the pace of this game, not even just taking into consideration the Aegis. I think they're just going to be very comfortable playing at a pace where they're the ones finding pickoffs, continuing to pick up BKBs as well. Not a huge rush necessarily. Okay, they will go for one as Windranger's next item, even before the Aghanim Scepter. And I think once they have like triple BKB, this Secret's teamfight has very limited physical damage, but they've got the ability to blow up heroes before they get BKBs off with a Blink Echo, with a Roar, and potentially later on with something like a Puck Hex. Although the Aghanim Scepter may be the better option to have an answer for the BKBs.
So then it comes down to a lot of it being vision for Wings and also potentially trying to find initiation of their own. It just seems unlikely in those sort of pushing scenarios where Wings go forward with their BKBs, it's unlikely for them to be able to get the initiation first.
Yeah, absolutely. And with a Hawk on the side of Secret, I think Wings are going to have to use smokes very well in the late game when they want to try and take objectives. They've got to be the ones getting the jump onto Secret and making sure they get value out of their BKBs.
We'll see whether or not this smoke turns into value. Completed Mjolnir now for the Furion. As they go for a three-man rush through Radiant Jungle.
And Secret may be thrown off because they see Shadow with their Observer Ward, so the rest of the smoked up heroes could find a pickoff as a result, and yeah, Envy has an Aegis, but that may be at least a ability to kill him once.
Can they get both? They're going to lead Telekinesis into Orchid. Eternal Envy is definitely going to be dying one time here. Can they get him a second time? It doesn't look like they're going to set up for it at all. They just immediately back themselves out. Oh, Shadow reappears with the Shadow Blade, an attempt at a silence, but doesn't actually catch Eternal Envy. He managed to make the jump away, and that means Secret will claim the tier 2.
They like feigned that they were backing off, but Envy was covering all his bases there with that Remnant away.
Oh, now the jump forward. Dream Coil on the ice. No hope at escaping that one, that's for sure. Free pickoff.
So doing a good job too. I mean, they didn't push with the Aegis, but effectively a lot of that damage they deal, taking the tier 2 tower top, finding the Rubick pickoff, comes as a result of Envy having an Aegis, because he tanks the gank at bottom, doesn't actually lose his real life. And then meanwhile, the rest of the team Secret were pushing top. They were kind of trying to set up for Envy to be able to TP in and force a fight at the top lane, but Wings at least make sure that they're not going to have to defend their high ground.
Yeah, that was it's a pretty good point. It's funny how so much of this game for Wings actually just comes down to Roshan. Roshan fight number one obviously gave up so much tempo for a Drow Ranger lineup, and then Roshan number two actually stops Wings from being able to go high ground and force Secret into a defensive position. And this now means that Secret are actually farming pretty efficiently. Like, they're all three of their cores are looking... I say cores, I'm referring to the Beastmaster now as a core. Earthshaker is kind of taking a backseat to that guy, but all three of their cores are looking really healthy.
And the kind of irony of this game is Wings, their draft and just playstyle is going to turn into what Secret normally do, which is force the split push game, play keep, avoid team fights, and look for pickoffs. This is what we saw Secret in their opening game against Na'Vi, and just often their playstyle, like Envy loves those kind of games. Like, this is what Wings are going to have to adapt now if they want to win this game.
Another tower for Secret. Going to be claimed as Wings, not putting up a fight here for the tier 1. Looks like they may try and fight for tier 2 though.
And no real intent to get involved with that one, and Nature's Prophet just farming away what he can. The BKB on Blink is likely going to be what could change things for Wings as far as being able to fight into Secret when they're pushing. And Secret pushing is the one time where Wings may actually be able to get off a good initiation, because you've got clear vision at least of one or two heroes on the front lines. Someone like the Beastmaster, if you can get the jump on him, there isn't the best defensive place to save him if you're just a BKB, Windranger, or Drow Ranger who initiates on the Beastmaster. He's just straight up dead. Whereas Wings, they get initiated, there's always that potential for a relocate save out of innocence.
That is something to be said. If the BKBs finished up for Wings, the Aegis goes down. Do you think Wings actually try and, say, take that tier 2 in mid? Do you think they actually start getting a little bit aggressive and trying to force fights with these BKBs? Because if they do continue to play more of a split pushy farm game, there are opportunities where Secret are going to be able to catch you and maybe kill you before you pop that BKB, or even just pop the charges, which Wings are still going to be very dependent on going later into the game.
I think going for a straight up push like for the tier 2 mid is going to set Secret up for that exact thing, though, where they can catch you before you BKB. Like, Secret will just go for that smoke flank, but...
Shadow, oh, he's going to be spotted out here, knows it too, does manage to get the silence on the universe, that's going to be a big one. They take him out, as well as the Ancient Apparition almost immediately. Now the Primal Roar is going to be wasted, the relocate forward, hoping to be able to get Arteezy, but he orbs himself away, and now here begins the TPs, 1, 2, and 3, all able to make it out. Blink didn't have the Shackle shot up in time.
I mean, great initiation. That's the thing. Wings have to catch him by surprise with these smoke plays. They need to be the ones getting the jump. They find the two supports, which is actually fine when it's a hero like Earthshaker, who is so important for the side of Secret when they're trying to take team fights, even against BKBs. He can split up the heroes, prevent the chase using that. Envy. Let's be careful here. No relocate available, but...
Controlling Blink. Buying time, the Primal Roar still not up. The body blocking beautifully set up. Now the Yule Scepter into the orb, has to pop the BKB. The mech will be able to help keep Wings alive here. Ancient Apparition, Ice Blast may still allow Seeker to push forward, as sure enough, Eternal Envy goes for Bian, but doesn't want to stretch it too far. Tries to go for the Sleight of Fist chains, but not good enough. So double blink back, and Wings will return to their side of the map. One BKB charge down.
I think it's a scenario where Wings, if they can get the next Roshan, they're in a like great position to actually be able to push and force fights, because it means they can have a frontline who has an Aegis. So if they get jumped by the Roar or the Earthshaker and they die without getting their BKB off, they have the second life. But
right.
For Secret, it's more like they need to take Roshan just to stay in this game in some ways. An Aegis on Secret doesn't really allow them to push high ground. It just denies it from Wings more than anything.
Yeah. Now we have the BKB. BKB over Manta on the Ember Spirit in this game. He has to worry about Orchid as well as the Drow Ranger Silence, both of which can be dispelled with Manta. Why do you think BKB is Eternal Envy's choice?
It's going to, again, like you say, there's, if you pop the Manta, you want to be able to fight after it, but there's a secondary silence, the Drow Ranger silence, which you don't even have to find the real Manta illusion, because it'll just catch all three. There's Shackle Shots, there's Telekinesis. It just means after you popped it to get out of that first silence, you can then fight for 10 seconds.
Right.
Whereas a Manta style, you pop it to get out of the silence, and it's purely an escape tool where you then remnant away. You can't follow it up by actually fighting.
Yeah. This kind of BKB, it does open up options for the Ember Spirit to just go straight into that Drow Ranger.
Yeah.
And challenge her in team fights.
And Envy's a player who sometimes goes for unconventional fighting items on his Ember.
Telekinesis, they get the control on Eternal Envy. They will be able to take him out, and the BKB charge used as well.
The fact he got to use BKB means he could have remnanted.
But did he have a remnant up?
It was on the high ground. The right clicks would have followed him and killed him, I believe, though.
Either way,
he has no buyback.
Eternal Envy just not fast enough, and Wings might be able to take advantage of that buyback being down. 300 gold is what he needed. Wings don't know that, but they may just try and force it out of him anyway. Soon they're going to find out that there's nothing there. It's the tier 3 tower getting chipped away.
I swear that Dragon Lancer range on the low ground just brings down towers, even when pushing into the enemy base.
Little Scepter leading the way, and that is going to be a silence stolen by Ice. Not bad considering you have the Blink, but they're going to try and catch Blink. They manage to blow him up. Shadow is going to be actually up next. They get the Primal Roar Necronomicon onto him. The two big damage dealers of Wings are already gone, and they don't even need the Ember Spirit, apparently.
That just happened too fast. Wings just got completely caught out by surprise, and again, you've got to be able to get the BKBs off to get value out of them, and that's exactly what Wings were unable to do. Great initiation from Universe. All the attention from Wings initially is on that Wind Ranger who got jumped, so the IO is like, oh crap, can I relocate, save him? And it's already too late. And then they don't catch the Wind Ranger, who then gets followed up with a Roar. So
yeah,
neither BKB goes off, and just very ballsy play from Secret, defending their high ground without even having to use the Ember Spirit.
Does feel like another mistake, because Wind Ranger was missing a decent chunk of HP.
Oh, yeah.
Before Earthshaker managed to get the opening on him. Oh, top lane. Looks like they're going to be able to get a combo here on Puppy. And that is the gem. I'm not sure. Is that... Yeah, that's actually Puppy's gem.
Yeah.
That wasn't something they claimed from Wings or anything like that. So that is actually a very significant pickoff. Can't believe Puppy was that far forward with that item.
Yeah, he win a big fight. Perhaps just in his head, he's getting a bit overconfident and thinking he can just push out that top lane and can rebuy it, but effectively an 1800 gold swing with the gem swinging the way of Wings. And something that does become very important with this next Roshan fight coming up is going to be the vision game.
We have the Dream Coil, and that is an Ags upgrade for the Pucks. So that means these BKBs are actually going to become a little bit more useless for Wings. But that's only if they actually need to move,
yeah,
whether it's forward or back.
And their range series. It's not like it's an Ags puck against a Sven or someone who has to chase you with his Warcry and gets kited around by it. If you're a Drow or a Wind Ranger, you just BKB, and if they run, you hit the racks because you're using these BKBs on the enemy high ground. Mm-hmm. So I don't mind the item pickup for the puck. I just don't think it's as effective against the BKBs as it is in other scenarios.
Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be most effective when the fight is kind of already won or the initiation is strong enough that Wings are forced to retreat. But with that Aegis in hand, it seems unlikely. Wings are probably going to be, as you said, in a situation where if you try and back out with the Dream Coil on wings, they're just going to start hitting your buildings.
And with
this being the third Aegis, it's cheese as well. So this push could just be a straight up man fight out of wings. They may just try and force the issue without even caring about having someone like the drone on the front lines getting blown up. Does make life a lot more difficult. They need to have buyback on heroes like Ember Spirit this time, which Envy for now does have. Puck, similar story.
Ice Ice has played this pretty well. He's almost got an Ags. 37 minutes.
There's a lot of
That's
good spells.
Good for Rubick.
The spells to steal this game are pretty nice with the Shaker Fissure, Echo Slam, the Beastmaster Roar we've seen him steal once.
Mm.
Puck Orb slash Coil could be good.
Yeah.
Primal Roar is obviously unlikely he'll get Ice Blast, so Primal Roar is obviously the big ability that with an Axe upgrade.
Oh, and now he's been orchided as well. Oh. He committed the Yules offensively.
And that means he'll take out.
That was not the needed to just defensively Yules there, but didn't realize there were more heroes rotating in, and with Puck dead. Imagine Wings are going to at least go for this tier 2 tower and possibly poke at the high ground to force that buyback.
Oh, blink inwards as he gets the telekinesis. They're going to try and follow that up with a silence, but unfortunately, relocate is just a tad too late. And now they miss out on the opportunity. A secondary pickoff that would have allowed Wings to immediately go high ground. There's still 45 seconds left on the puck, though.
And I think the Hex from the Nature's Prophet was still in cooldown, but Faith Beyond has it again for the push now. They're not going to bother with that mid-tier 2 tower and instead swing bottom. It's always a lot easier to push these side lanes against these big power teamfighting heroes who want to initiate on you because there's fewer ways for them to actually initiate when they can't come from below. They have got to come from their high ground or from above.
Yeah, you could see plenty of vision, especially with the Sprout Pylai Dai going to be the target here. They want to be able to take away that Ice Blast. BKB activated by Blink is going to be able to prevent a lot of the incoming damage. They get Eternal Envy instead with the Primal Roar stolen by Ice Ice, as now they look for more. Push back Blink. He's going to be Dream Coiled up. Universe makes his entrance with an Echo Slam, trying to finish up Blink, but no! Can't quite get him in time. And now Wings will be able to save Blink, and he turns on a Universe, killing him, taking him out of the fight. RTZ going to be up next. Shackle shot it, taken away. Eternal Envy goes for the two. Will be able to get both the Wisps as well as the Windranger, but it cost him his own life, and now Universe may even die back here. That's 70 seconds for the Puck, 90 seconds for the Ember Spirit. Wings, with their big core still up, and now relocate in from both the Wisps as well as the Windranger, they can clean up a second lane of Rax as well atop.
Yeah, knowing that both the main cores have seen
or maybe
the
just go straight for
yet,
Throne.
They bolt back the Windranger. They can really just take out at least multiple lanes of Rax, possibly just get the GG off of this. There's no Echo, no Roar, nothing to defend with, and Wings, all it took was one Roshan, and game goes their way.
Just like that, Secret. A couple of pickoffs, and all of a sudden that just turns into the game outright. Straight up thrown with a Drow Ranger strat. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Secret. You thought, like, some of this game looked okay. The pickoffs weren't great. Like, Secret losing, say, Puppy at the top lane, losing Artur a little bit later. Like, those were really unfortunate deaths, but some of that game